king. And you have blessed us with life, consciousness, and a moral fiber and being that we can worship you. This morning, as we come into your presence, we ask that you would come and visit with us, that through the agency of your Spirit and your ministering spirits, who excel in strength, we invite them into this place to inspire us to a deeper relationship with you. We ask these things in that matchless name of him who is called Wonderful Counselor, the Mighty God, and the Prince of Peace. Even in Jesus' name do we pray. Amen. I would like to begin with the choir that I bring with me. And the song that the Morgan State University Choir will sing for us today is great. There are many guests and visitors here, which we appreciate. I've met Dennis earlier. So Dennis, glad to have you here today. And there are others that we're glad that you're here. Marcy was ill a little bit ago, a few days ago. And so we're really thankful that you're back with us. And we know that Ed missed a few weeks, and he's back with us today. Good to see you, Ed. Always good to see you. And there may be others as well who have been out ill who are back, and it's good to see you. I want you to think along with me today on the subject, something greater than the name of Jesus. Something greater than the name of Jesus. Now, after the fall of Adam and Eve, when Adam and Eve sinned, sin entered the world. It was a new phenomenon in God's perfect universe. And sin came into the world, and now we are reaping the results of Adam and Eve's decision to disobey God. Now, after the fall, Adam and Eve, in this, again, perfect world, until they fell, they had to come up with a cure, or at least God came up with a cure for the situation that they found themselves in. And so God had to create a way of atonement. He could have destroyed Adam and Eve, as you know, immediately, and there would not have been any violation whatsoever on the part of God if he would have done that, because he told them, if you eat of the tree, in that day you shall surely die. And they did exactly that. Now, as soon as they they ate of the tree, this quotation comes to mind, and it comes from the book Faith to Live By, page 75. And you'll also find it in volume 1 of the SDA Bible Commentary, page 85. And the servant of the Lord writes, "The instant man accepted the temptations of Satan and did the very things that God had said that he should not do, Christ, the Son of God, stood between the living and the dead, saying, 'Let the punishment of man fall upon me. I will stand in man's place. He shall have another chance.'" Are you thankful for that? She says on page 1084 of the Bible Commentary, she says, "As soon as there was sin, there was a Savior." And I'm glad for that. Jesus is the foundation of the Christian faith. He is the Savior of the world, the King of Kings. Jesus is the central and critical figure. He is the hero of the Bible. Somebody might say, well, who, you know, every drama has a hero. Who's the hero of this book that you call the Bible? The hero of this book is none other than Jesus Christ himself. The Bible foreshadowed the coming of Jesus and the coming controversy between Christ and Satan. And if you turn in your Bibles to Genesis chapter 3, Genesis chapter 3 and verse 15, and this is what the Bible says. Genesis 3 and verse 15. And it says, "And I will put enmity," that's hatred, "between you," he's talking now to the serpent, "and the woman, between your seed," that is the seed of Satan or Lucifer, "and her seed," that is the church, that's me and you. And he goes on to say, "He shall bruise thy head," the serpent will bruise, I should say, Christ will bruise the head of Satan, "and you shall bruise his heel," that is, Satan will bruise the heel of Christ in that he would be crucified on a cross for you and for me. And so in the Old Testament then, this in the Old Testament sanctuary service, this foreshadowed the coming of Christ and what he would do in order to remedy man from the great error of his way. And what the sinner had to do in the Old Testament in order to atone for his sin, if he wanted to be forgiven of his sin, he had to go and find a lamb of a year old. And these instructions were given in the book of Leviticus. And he would bring a lamb to the priest, and he would take his hand and he would put it on the head of the lamb, and as if to transfer his sin onto the innocent lamb. And he would put his head, his hands on the head of the lamb, an unblemished lamb. And in transferring his sin to the innocent lamb, now the lamb bore his sin. He was forgiven of his sin, and now the innocent lamb received his sin on himself. And of course, the lamb was slain. And as we look at our lamb here today, that ceremony was to teach the children of Israel the high price of the death of Jesus that our sins, when we kneel down and pray, our sins after the cross are now, they don't just disappear in the thin air. They are now transferred onto our sin bearer, who is Savior, who is our Savior, who is typified by the Lamb. And there you see the man there. The Bible says in Leviticus 1 and verse 4, he shall put his hand on the head of the burnt offering, and it will be accepted on behalf to make atonement for him. An innocent lamb. The lamb didn't do anything. But it was the man who sinned in this photograph. But he transferred his sin onto the innocent lamb. John calls him the lamb slain from the foundation of the world. And according to the law, Paul says in the book of Hebrews, all things are purified with blood, and without the shedding of blood, there is no remission. So in order for Jesus to redeem me and you back, there had to be the shedding of blood. Why? Because for the life of the flesh is in the blood, Leviticus 17 and verse 11. So the price that we pay, and I said this to you last time I was here, that people say that salvation is free. No, it's not, because it cost heaven its star. It cost heaven its Christ. The Son of God had to shed his blood for you and for me in order for us to have redemption and salvation. In him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of our trespasses according to the riches of his grace. Knowing that you are now redeemed, you are not redeemed with corruptible things like silver or gold from your aimless conduct received by tradition from your fathers, but with the precious blood of Christ as of a lamb without blemish and without spot, a precious lamb who foreshadowed the Lamb of God. If we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus Christ, his Son, cleanses us from all sin. And you were justified in the name of the Lord Jesus and by the Spirit of our God, 1 Corinthians 6 and verse 11. And so now we, with all that he has done for us, the redemption of his blood, his sacrifice, his crucifixion, his voluntary sacrifice for us. Now we can understand why that name is so important, the name of Jesus. The Bible says that we should do everything, everything in the name of Jesus, that the name of our Lord Jesus may be glorified in you, and you in him, according to the grace of our God and the Lord Jesus Christ. I write unto you, little children, because your sins are forgiven for his name's sake. His name. These things have I written to you who believe in the name of the Son of God, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow. And I want to thank the young lady who read our scripture text this morning. She did a wonderful job, didn't she? Did a very wonderful job. Thank you so much. And it goes on to say, and of those on earth and those under the earth, and every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. The name of Jesus. Nor is there salvation in any other, for there is no other name under heaven given among men by which we must be saved, the Bible says. And the name of the Lord Jesus was magnified in the New Testament church, as we are to magnify his name today. We should be baptized in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Then Peter said, silver and gold I do not have, but what I do have I give to you in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Rise up and walk. By stretching out your hand to heal, and that signs and wonders may be done through the name of your holy servant Jesus. Talking about the name of Jesus now. I will worship before we get to that text. All of these texts are teaching us about the name of Jesus, how the sick are healed in his name, how demons are defeated by the name of Jesus. In fact, I had a slide in there. I don't know what. Oh, there it is. But Paul, greatly annoyed, turned and said to the spirit, the evil spirit, I command you in the name of Jesus Christ, to come out of her. He came out that very hour. There was another slide I had. I don't know where it went. But Jesus, the name of Jesus, is the thing that, here's one. And Peter said, silver, I think I've already read this one, that he was able to heal this man because of the name of Jesus. The name of Jesus is powerful. The name of Jesus is a necessary element in defeating the powers of the enemy. Mrs. White talks about the fact that the weakest sinner on their knees will cause the devil to scramble and run. The name of Jesus. And so now, with all of this on the name of Jesus, one is wondering, what could be greater than the name of Jesus? And here it is. Some people say, well, how in the world could anything be greater than that name? And how can something be better than that name? Where does it say that in the Bible, that there's something greater than the name of Jesus? Here it is. I will worship your toward your holy temple and praise your name for your loving kindness and your truth. For you have magnified your word above all your name. Psalm 138 and verse 2. People believe that because of the name of their church, that this will earn them salvation. It will not. Now, the name of your church is important. I'm proud to say that I'm a Seventh-day Adventist. I'm proud of that fact. I'm proud of our sanctuary message. I'm proud of our message about the Seventh-day Sabbath, which is etched in the Ten Commandments on stone. I'm proud of that. I'm proud that we are a people that take the second coming of Jesus to the world, to ready the world for the second coming. I'm proud of the three angels' messages of Revelation chapter 14. I'm proud of that. I'm proud of our message on righteousness by faith in Christ alone. I'm proud of that. But I also know that the name Seventh-day Adventist is not going to save me. I was telling someone just yesterday there was a group of people in our neighborhood, about 6 weeks ago. And they knocked on my door, and I answered the door, and they said, we would like to study with you. We would like to study the Watchtower with you. And I said, well, bless the Lord, yes, I would be glad to study with you. And now it's been 6 weeks, and I can't speak for them, but I'm having a good time. And they make a lot of the name Jehovah. And I had to inform them that the name Jehovah does not appear anywhere in the Bible in terms of the original transcripts. Now, we have it transliterated in our Bibles today so that you can see the name Jehovah at different places. But in the original Hebrew, you did not have the name Jehovah. There it is. That's what you have in Hebrew. You got YHWH. That's what appears in the Septuagint version, which is the Greek version of the Old Testament. That's what appears in the Hebrew version of the Old Testament. But the name Jehovah is completely and totally absent. And so what happened was, in the intertestament period between the Old and the New Testament, you have a group called the Masoretes. The Masoretes, who came along and said, you know, that's kind of hard to pronounce. And so what we're going to do is we will go ahead and add vowels to those consonants. And this happened between the 5th and the 10th centuries BC. And so they added vowels to the YHWH, and they transliterated this to read Jehovah. Now, there's nothing wrong with Jehovah, that name. We use it. The spirit of prophecy, it's in there. We use it in our classrooms to teach, our sermons to preach. Nothing wrong with the name. But the problem is when you have a group of people who swear that if you don't have that name, if you don't use that name, then you are not God's people. And so I had to instruct them that the name that you revere so highly does not appear anywhere in the scriptures. So every time you pronounce the name Jehovah, you may be mispronouncing, and you probably are mispronouncing that name. The name is, a name is important. But the reason why God says that I magnify my word above all my name is because you can call yourself anything. There's no salvation in it. Isaiah reminds us in Isaiah 4 and verse 1, he says, and in that day, seven women shall take hold of one man, saying, we will eat our own food and wear our own apparel. Only let us be called by your name to take away our reproach. In this day and time, because men went to war and they died, there was a dearth of available men. And so you would have a number of women who would run down after a man to take that name upon them so that they would not have the reproach of being single, an old maid. But they said, we want to eat our own food. We want to dress the way we want to dress. We want to live the way we want to live, but only let us have your name. And that's the way many Christian churches are today. They say, we don't want to obey the commandments. We don't want to obey the scriptures. Like the people who were visiting my house once a week, they were so dissatisfied with the Bibles that were available to most Christians that they went out and wrote their own. And they wrote it in such a way that it is not faithful to the original text, but it feeds into their preconceived ideas. And so I have to remind my friends when they come to the house, and I do love them, I have to remind them when we read certain texts that your Bible has changed the meaning of the words, or have added or have taken away from the original text in order to satisfy their preconceived notions. And so now we have these seven women who are going after the one man. Now these seven women represents three classes of people. Number one, it represents those who want to be called Christian, but whose life and morality falls decidedly short. They are unfit to have title to heaven. They live one way on Friday night or Saturday night, and then they can be seen at church a couple of times a year, claiming to be Christians. It reminds me of a story that I'm sure you've heard about squirrels. And there were these four churches who had a squirrel problem. There was a Baptist church. There was a Presbyterian church, there was a Methodist church, and a Catholic church. And so one day, the Presbyterian pastor in this small Texas town called a meeting to decide, what are we going to do about these squirrels? And after much consideration, they determined that the squirrels were predestined. Therefore, we better leave them alone. And then the Methodist church decided, well, you know, we better turn this over to the deacons and see what they're going to say about this thing. The deacons decided, well, since a lot of them are back here in the baptistry, let's just drown them. We'll turn the water on and let them drown. So they turned the water on, and somehow the squirrels escaped. And they were right back there the following week. The Catholic group got together and decided, well, we're not in a position really to harm, you know, the Lord's creatures. So let's just take them out a few miles and leave them there, and That'll be the end of our problem. 3 days later, the squirrels were back in mass. The Baptist Church came up with the best solution. They baptized the squirrels, made them members of the church, and so now they only see them on Easter and Christmas. Hypocrisy. The second group that these seven women represent are a reverse engineering type of group. Like the people I'm studying with, they have a religious idea in mind, and they will force the Bible to agree with their ideas, whether the Bible wants to or not. And sad to say, this group has so anchored their faith in what they believe that they can look right at a biblical text. Now, I gotta tell you this. A couple of weeks ago, they came and we were having some discussion, and the issue was God's name. And they said, well, God's name is Jehovah. And I said, well, yeah, that's true. I said, but God, Jehovah has other names in the Bible as well. He said, no, they told me, no, he doesn't. That's his name. And I said, what about Luke 1:49, where Mary says to the angel Gabriel, holy is his name. And that's what it says in the book of Psalms 111, verse 9, that reverent is his name. And so they looked at the passage that said, holy is his name. And the man looked at me and said, no, holy is not his name. I said, what are you talking about? It says it right there. He said, no, holy is not his name. I said, well, the Bible says it is. You said it's not. Should I believe you or should I believe the Bible? It was at that point that he yielded the matter and said, well, I got to go look into it. This reverse engineering group, the third group, not only do we have the first group of hypocrisy, the second group of reverse engineering, but we have this third group. This third group has the truth, except that it waters it down so much that it's hardly recognizable. And like these seven women, these people want the name of their church, whether Seventh-day Adventist or whatever, you know, but I'll use the Seventh-day Adventist Church because I said truth, and the Seventh-day Adventist Church has the truth. And nonetheless, this group has people in it, some people, some pastors, some members, who water down the truth so much that it's hardly recognizable as coming out of the Bible. Now, I want you to notice what Jesus said in the book of Matthew, chapter 7. Jesus, and I want you to take careful note of this. Jesus said, not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, shall enter the kingdom of heaven, but he who does the will of my Father, his will as expressed in his word. I magnify my word above all my name. And so now you've got people who are using the name, but they're not doing his will. And he says, many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in your name? Cast out demons in your name? Done many wonders in your name? And then he will declare unto them, and these are the four most saddest words in the Bible. The Lord will say to them who use his name, the Lord will say to them, I never knew you. I don't know who you are. You use my name, but I want you to know that I magnified my word above all my name. And you haven't done my will. You haven't done my will. And he says, and then I will declare to them, I never knew you. Depart from me who practice lawlessness. Build on the rock. Therefore, whoever hears these sayings of mine and doeth them will liken him to a wise man who built his house on a rock. And the rain descended and the floods came and the winds beat on that house and did not fall, for it was founded on the rock. But everyone who hears these sayings of mine and does not do them will be like a foolish man who built his house on the sand, and the rain descended and the floods came and the winds blew and beat on that house, and it fell, and great was its fall. What Paul says in Thessalonians, 1 Thessalonians 5, 5 and 6, you are all children of the light, and we get our light from the word. And the children of the day, we are not of the night nor of darkness. Therefore, let us not sleep as do others, but let us watch and be sober. Now, some churches come up with a theology. They twist themselves into pretzels trying to explain away Bible texts. Like these people that come over to my house. They twist themselves into a pretzel shape in order to deny what the Bible clearly says on a given topic. And it works something like this. Why are fire engines red? Well, they have four wheels and eight men. 4 + 8 = 12. 12 inches make a ruler. A ruler is Queen Elizabeth. Queen Elizabeth sails the seven seas. The seven seas have fish. The fish have fins. The fins hate the Russians. The Russians are red. Fire engines are always Russian, so they're red. And that's what some of these people sound like, trying to explain a biblical doctrine. And so the only way that you can be prepared for this is that you have to be a student of the Bible. You've got to not read it. No. You've got to study it. And know what it says and why, so that you're not twisted up into a pretzel shape like this. Mrs. White says, I was told that men will employ every policy to make less prominent the differences between the faith of Seventh-day Adventists and those who observe the first day of the week. You go to some of our churches now, and unfortunately, it sounds like you are in a, I won't, you know, name different churches, but churches who have a truth that seems more like plaster than anything real that feeds the soul. And we're getting that way in some of our churches. Instead of being proud of who we are and who what we teach, there are some churches that are trying so hard to be like everybody else that we lose the distinctiveness of our message. Paul says, study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not be ashamed, rightly dividing the words of truth. Now, I want to give you an example of why it's important to study the Bible. Number one, it's important to study the Bible because what this page tells us is that the Bible tells us and shines the light on the divinity, the deity, and the equality of Jesus with the Father. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The Word that it's talking about is Jesus Christ in John 1:1. Now I want to explain something. Some of you already know this, but I want to explain it to others. That the Word that appears three times in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was God, and was with God, and the Word was God. That word was, in the Greek, is the word ein, E-N. It's a what's called an imperfect verb. Not, it doesn't mean that it's not perfect. It's totally different than that meaning. That's just the name of the tense of this verb. It's called the imperfect verb. And what that means, and I explained it to my friends who come by my house once a week, what that means is, the imperfect tense means, is you go back 1,000 years, Ain means that the word was one day before that. You go back 1,000,000,000 years, the word ain means the word was one day before that. You go back 1,000,000,000,000,000 years, ain means that the word was one day before that. You never can find a beginning to the word. Now, my friends have said to me, well, if Jesus had a beginning, then he must be a created being. But that's not what the text says. It doesn't say that he had a beginning. It says that whatever beginning you want, he was there. And even if I didn't use that to show the timelessness of Jesus, look at the next verse, Micah 5:2, you know it well. But thou, Bethlehem, Ephrata, though thou be little among the thousands of Judea, of Judah, yet out of thee shall come forth unto me, that is to be a ruler in Israel, whose goings forth
have been from old, from what? From everlasting. So the timelessness of Jesus is not only proven in John 1:1, but its timelessness is seen in Micah 5:2. And then in Isaiah 9:6, it says, "For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulders, and his name shall be called Wonderful, Counselor, the Mighty God." And I have to share this with my friends who don't believe in the deity of Christ, that he's equal, that he himself is God. He is called the Mighty God and the Everlasting Father. He is everlasting, timeless, the Prince of Peace. And then we have John 5, verse 17 and 18. Again, we're talking about the equality of Jesus with the Father. And Jesus answered them, "My Father worketh hitherto, and I work." End of story. There it is. He said, "What in the world are you talking about? What is that saying? It is not saying anything." Well, it doesn't appear to say anything. But if you look behind it, it is a powerful statement of equality. You see, in the Greek, like in the English, there is a part of speech called a coordinate conjunction. And what that means in the Greek is where you have an emphatic rendering of ego and me before a verb. Ego and me, it is an intensification. And what that means is when Jesus said the subject and the context was healing on the Sabbath. And when Jesus said, "Well, look here, on the Sabbath, my Father worked and I work." What he was claiming is equality with God the Father, because it is a coordinating conjunction in the Greek. He says, "I am my Father, we are equal, and we both do our work even on the Sabbath." Guess what happened? The Jews understood that coordinating conjunction. Therefore, the Jews sought the more to kill him, because he not only had broken the Sabbath, he broke the Sabbath in terms of their rules, not in terms of God's law, but said also that God was his Father, not our Father. Jesus said, "My Father," making himself equal to God. They understood a coordinating conjunction, that what Jesus was saying, that me and the Father are equal and we work together. The timelessness and the power of Jesus Christ. This is why you and me both should study our Bibles, number one. It is because it unfolds the deity of Jesus as our sacrifice for our sins, that God would come down and he would expose himself to ridicule and punishment and persecution, and ultimately die an ignominious death on a cross.
That's what you call love.
Jesus said unto him, again, it is written, thou shalt not tempt the Lord thy God. Wait a minute. How is it that Jesus can say this, thou shalt not tempt the Lord thy God? In every instance, he says, it is written.
He pointed to the Bible. He pointed to God's word as being a hammer to defeat Satan.
The power that we have, you and me, over Satan is God's written word.
We say, it is written. But if I don't know what's in here, how can I beat the devil away? It is the written word that we have.
Another reason why you and I ought to study the Bible is because it helps you and me in our daily life to know that God is always near. Am I a God? At hand, saith the Lord, and not a God afar off. Jeremiah 23:23. And what he's saying is,
don't you dare think that I don't care about the least of your concerns. Don't you ever think that I don't care about the sickness and disappointment that you're going through, the failure that you're feeling, the bills that are due. You remember a story, I'm almost done, by the way. You remember the story of Rabshakeh in the book of 2 Kings, I believe it's 2 Kings 6, where Rabshakeh, who was the military leader of the Syrians, he came to Israel wanting to intimidate them into paying Syria their taxes. And Rabshakeh said to Hezekiah's servants, he said, I want you to go and tell Hezekiah that I'm about to destroy him. And you better tell Hezekiah that he better not trust in this God of his. Every nation that we have defeated, they have a God that they trust in. And their gods are a heap of ashes. So tell Hezekiah, don't trust in that God. So they went back and they gave, Rabshakeh gave Hezekiah letters. Rabshakeh gave Hezekiah servants letters to give to Hezekiah. And so they went to Hezekiah, basically saying the same thing, and they gave them to Hezekiah, and they were shaking at their knees. They said, Rabshakeh is going to destroy us. And here are letters to that effect. So what did Rabshakeh do? Rabshakeh went into the temple. He went into the church. And he spread the letters. He spread them out on the altar before the most holy place and the holy place. He spread them out. And he said, Lord, he got on his knees and he said, Lord, this is your mail. And God went the next day into the Syrian camp, he sent his angels, two of them, I believe, and he sent his angels down there and killed 185,000 Syrians. God, this is your mail. And so God wants you to know that he's not afar off, but he's near to you and to me. Whatever we're going through, he is a God who is near. That's why we ought to study our Bibles, to know this God who is near to us in the time of grief and heartache. And then finally, we ought to serve this God of ours. Let's see, where are my notes? Let's see. Here it is. That's not it. Anyway, the fifth thing, we ought to study our Bibles because it is the roadmap to heaven. Mrs. White has a quote about how in studying the Bible, she said there is no better way to feed and to develop our intellect than to study the Bible. And so I'm hoping that instead of going down here to the university to study physics, and nothing wrong with that, but we shouldn't avoid or delay or put aside the study of the Bible. That's going to do more to develop this gray matter than any subject that you can take down at the University of Washington or at any other college or university. And so I want to close by saying, God says to you and to me, I have magnified my word above all my name, because it is in studying this book that we find eternal life and a better life in the here and the now, if we obey what God has outlined for us in this book to obey. Now I want to close by playing a video. Again, this is my choir that I travel with, and they're going to sing it as well. I would like for you to stand and sing. I think it's hymn number 530. If you choose to sing along with them, hymn number 530, "It Is Well With My Soul." And you can play that now. That was beautiful. I want to make a very short appeal to those. I know I'm way over time, but I want to make a real short appeal. There may be someone here today who wants to say, you know, I'm interested in this truth that you're talking about, that the Seventh-day Adventist Church has the truth. We do have the truth on many different important subjects in the Bible. And you want to say to yourself, you know, I want to study my Bible more. I want to know my Savior, this timeless Savior. And so I want somebody to give me Bible studies, come by my house or Zoom or phone, and I want to learn more about what you believe, because I want to give my heart to the Lord Jesus Christ. If this is your desire, can you just shoot your hand up real quick? Those of you may want Bible studies. And then my second appeal is to those who are members of the church, want to say, you know, I haven't been studying my Bible. It's been gathering dust, or, you know, the only time I use it is when I go to church. But I think now I'm going to have to start studying my Bible, not just reading it every now and then, but I'm going to start daily studying. If this is your desire, can you just raise your hand and say, well, yes, I got to study my Bible more. When David said that I magnify, when David was relating God's words, saying that I will magnify my word above all my name, is that suggesting to you how important it is for us to study his word? If he magnifies his word above his name, how important is it for us to study this word and to know the truth, the truths that he is teaching us today? Well, I'm going to say a closing prayer, our benediction, and then we will be dismissed. Father in heaven, thank you, Lord, for your word. We thank you for your word, your timeless Savior, Jesus Christ. And we also thank you for the written word. And may we determine that from this day forward, we won't just casually read this book, but that we will study it and know what you have indicated for us in terms of Bible doctrine that will deepen our love for you and for your truths that you teach in your word. Lord, I pray for every person under the sound of my voice that they will commit their time and of their effort to study your word that you've magnified above your name, and how important your name is, but your word, you've magnified it even above that. Oh, Lord, help us to value this book and to make it precious, a life and death matter for us to study and to know this book and to be able to say that our love for you has grown. The more we study, the more we fall in love with you. I pray that this is our desire. In Jesus' precious and timeless name, we pray. Amen.